Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. That's better. Such a beautiful night, we have to focus, because you're going to hear a really wonderful concert of music tonight. And the fact that I'm in a tuxedo in itself is something to say, because I think the last time I was in a tuxedo at the casino was 1954, when Louis and Elaine Lorillard and Jimmy Van Allen were gracious enough to invite us here to do the first Newport Jazz Festival. And 20 years ago, this summer, we did a tribute to Louis Armstrong, which was really his last hurrah. It was the last performance that Louis gave in concert. He died a year later. It was one of the most thrilling nights that we ever had at the Newport Jazz Festival. Well, now, tonight at the JVC Newport Jazz Festival, we're going to have another thrilling night, because another generation has come along to keep the music of Louis Armstrong with us. It's a historic evening, and I think it's something that you're going to remember for a long time to come. And as our host for this evening is a man who has been involved with the theater, with television, with the Broadway stage. He and his wife personify the same excellence in theater and drama that Louis Armstrong did in music. And let's welcome him here tonight, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Ozzie Davis. Ozzie.
Thank you. And good evening. It was recently discovered in a New Orleans church register that Louis Armstrong was born on August 4th, 1901. But Louis claimed for most of his years to have been born on July 4th, 1900, a true child of the American century. Since jazz, the music that Louis aptly represented for 45 years as its greatest epic hero, is the centerpiece of American culture in this century, it is only fitting that we take Louis at his word and his wish and celebrate his 90th anniversary this year. Music was an important part of New Orleans' functional community life when Louis was a youngster. The younger musicians could serve interactive apprenticeships, more common in African communities. From birth, the New Orleanian participated in traditional ceremonies which were accompanied by a specific body of songs, chants, and grooves, as well as an improvisatory interreaction between dance and music. The master musicians, such as Joe Oliver, Jelly Roll Morton, Bunk Johnson, Freddie Kippard, were also schooled in various types of concert band musics and instrumental techniques derived from European style instructions. In this musical climate, young Louis formed a formidable foundation that supported him through almost 50 years of relentless development. The joy, love, reverence that Louis had for the New Orleans of his youth was apparent whenever he spoke, and most importantly, it is etched into every note he ever played or sang. From his early youth, singing in a European-style barbershop quartet, to playing bass drum with the Waif's home band, to doing odd jobs around New Orleans with various bands, to improvising immaculate harmonies with the great Joe Oliver, Louis was preparing himself to be the primary representative of the New Orleans tradition and, as such, of modern American music. The way Louis both played and sang made a permanent mark upon American music. The generations of musicians who succeeded Armstrong owed him no less than their concept of form, phrasing, swing, and improvisation. Through the efforts of the great soloists and composers, such as Duke Ellington, Charlie Parker, John Coltrane, and Thelonious Monk, aspects of Louis' discoveries were developed further. It is easy for us, several generations later, to take for granted the fundamentals of jazz and Armstrong's Promethean position as illuminator of them. But we should realize that Louis Armstrong's mastery of these fundamentals, which he refined over his 50 years of public performance, placed the art of jazz at the center of 20th century innovations. Certainly, such great trumpeters as Roy Eldridge, Dizzy Gillespie, Doc Cheatham, Ruby Braff, and Clark Terry never forgot either what Louis meant to all of jazz or what he meant to them personally. And what a pleasure it is to count among these wonderful players the young jazz trumpet hero of our own time who has produced this show for us this evening. Ladies and gentlemen, Wynton Marsalis.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, for coming out this evening. Tonight we've organized the show to really be like a party. All the musicians come off and on. We don't really know in what order the songs are going to be, and everybody picks the tune they feel like playing on. This first song is one of Louis Armstrong's favorites, entitled Dear Old Southland.
Thank you.
Thank you very, very much, ladies and gentlemen. That was Mr. Eric Reed on the piano. Right now, we'd like to bring up a gentleman who's in his 80s. I won't tell you how high because he doesn't want me to divulge that information. But he can remember walking through the streets of Chicago carrying the horn of the great King Oliver in the early 1920s. And when we hear him play, we hear everything that trumpet playing actually is about. He has many anecdotes that he can tell, so I'm not going to use up any of his stories that he's told me. I'm just going to bring him on, and he's going to play on the sunny side of the street. Mr. Doc Cheatham on the trumpet. Mr. Jackie Byard on the piano.
I have quite a story about Louis Armstrong, and it'll take you about 6 weeks to if I could explain how lucky I was to come in contact with him. Sheer luck, because I was born in Nashville, Tennessee, and I was in Chicago, stranded. Not exactly, I was washing dishes downtown, you know, in my first couple of days in Chicago, and I was kind of disgusted with music. I hadn't heard anything, so one of the guys in the restaurant took me up and heard Louis Armstrong, Freddie Keppard, and Joe Oliver, and quite a few others up there, and then that kind of inspired me. So by meeting Lillian Armstrong, who was from Nashville, graduated from Nashville and Fisk University, and she was a good friend of Lillian Armstrong, which also graduated from Fisk University. Between the two of them, they gave me a card, a union card, because I didn't have the right to play in Chicago without a union card. Although they wouldn't let me play anyway because I wasn't from New Orleans. You had to be from New Orleans in those days to get a job in Chicago. But Louis Armstrong had he was such a strong man there that Al Capone, you know, gave him the okay to let me get a little job in Chicago. And that's how I came to meet Louis, and he gave me a few jobs himself and treated me very nice, and I wouldn't be here today if it wasn't for Louis Armstrong.
Thank you.
Doc Cheatham. Right now, we're going to bring out some very fine musicians from New Orleans, the original Liberty Brass Jazz Band. And they're going to come out and we're going to play some music in the style of traditional New Orleans. We have on the trombone, Mr. Freddie Lonzo. On the second cornet, Mr. Greg Stafford. On the first cornet, Mr. Teddy Riley. On the bass, Mr. Reginald Veal. On the drums, Mr. Herlin Riley. On the tuba, Wycliffe Pinecone Garden. On the banjo, the legendary Mr. Danny Barker. And the musical director on the clarinet, Dr. Michael White. The song we're about to play is a song that Louis Armstrong made famous in the 1920s. It's entitled The Potato Head Blues, and that was a description of somebody, one of our homeboys, somebody they knew. And that's all I have to say about it.
Thank you.
Potato Head Blues, including Louis solo, no less. Pops originally recorded that with the Hot Five group in 1927. Now, during the same sessions, he also popularized a new kind of singing, what we have come to know as scat singing. What it means is singing using improvised pseudo-words. It was a traditional New Orleans way of singing and entertaining in Louis' time, but it wasn't very widely known. During the recording of the vocal number, Heebie Jeebies, the page with the lyrics on it slipped away from Louis. He didn't remember the rest of the lyrics, but he didn't want to stop and ruin the recording. So he just continued to sing, using a kind of double talk instead of the lyrics. And he sang it with so much feeling and conviction that many people still claim to understand exactly what he was saying. Our next guest is a vocalist of indomitable swing, incredulous. She is a cast member of the hit Broadway show Black and Blue and takes up the mantle of Armstrong's vocal artistry for us tonight. And here she is with her own version of St. Louis Blues. Let us give a warm welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to Miss Carrie Smith.
I hate to see that evening sun go down, yeah. I hate to see that evening sun go down. It makes me think I'm on my last go round. Well, I'm feeling tomorrow just like I feel today. Feeling tomorrow just like I feel today. I'm gonna pack my trunk, yes, and make my getaway. St. Louis woman with all her diamond rings pulls my man around by her apron string. For powder, all that store-bought hair, that man of mine wouldn't have gone nowhere. Nowhere. I got the St. Louis blues, blue as I can be. That man's got a heart like a rock cast in the deep blue sea. Gone too far for me. Well, I love my man like a schoolboy loves his pie. And that old Kentucky colonel loves his rock and roll. I'm gonna love that man, love him till the day I die. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. That song was recorded in the 20s. Louis accompanied Miss Bessie Smith on that song, St. Louis Blues, many years ago. And if there are any singers in the house, you had better listen to Louis Armstrong, because his phrasing was just out of sight. And that's how I learned how to sing, listen to his trumpet. Yes. I want a big butt and egg man. Butter and egg man from way out in the west. I get so tired of working hard all day. I want somebody, oh, who wants to play. From way out in the west, yeah.
party. Who wants to play pretty close? I bet they won't mind. Oh, but when I get my sweetie, sun will shine. But every night, man, yeah. And I hope some every night, man, wants me.
You know, there's a whole generation of trumpet players that were influenced by the great Louis Armstrong. Right now we're going to bring up Mr. Bucky Pizzarelli on the guitar. And this gentleman to my left, one of the finest trumpet players in the world, Mr. Ruby Braff. And we were talking today about how Bunny Berrigan said that all you needed to be a musician on the road was a toothbrush and a picture of Louis Armstrong. And this gentleman was telling me today as we were eating breakfast about how streamlined Louis's playing was. And well, I'm not gonna spoil it. Go ahead.
Well, he's like the shark. He was finished and streamlined the day he entered this, emerged in music. And he fused that kind of life onto this musical planet that never existed before. Whether you sang, danced, whistled, wrote music, walked. Joe Louis, as a matter of fact, became a champion boxing to the music of Louis Armstrong. That just shows you. And after a while, Louis became the university, a university of music from which no musician ever graduated. Just the most remarkable man in the world. That's it.
Well, that's it. The song that Mr. Braff is about to play is a tune made famous once again by Louis Armstrong, a nice song entitled, come on, 40. Be cool, man. You see me talking, you talking all loud. Chill. This is a song entitled Pennies from Heaven.
Thank you. And now we're going to do a tune called Jubilee, written by Hoagy Carmichael, and bring up a couple of wonderful people. I've asked Winton and Doc and John Faddis to come up and help me out on this. It's a lovely tune. Let's bring them up with a nice hand.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ruby Braff, John Faddis, Doc Cheatham, trumpet. Right now we're gonna bring, thank you very much. We're gonna bring Miss Carrie Smith back, and she's gonna do another Louis Armstrong classic entitled, I Got a Right to Sing the Blues.
Louis and Jack Teagarden recorded this song a long time ago, and they were real good buddies, you know. I got a right to sing the blues. Yeah, Ruby. I got a right to sing the blues. Got a right to feel low down. I've got a right to hang around, down around the river. Certain man in this town keeps dragging my poor heart around, and all I see for me is misery. I got a right to sing the blues. I got a right to moan and sigh. I've got a right to sit and sigh down around the river. Soothe the deep blue sea. It's going to be calling me. It must be love, say what you choose. I've got a right to sing the blues. Oh, I've got a right to sing the blues, yeah. I got a right to feel low down, yeah. I got a right to hang around, down around, yeah, the muddy river. A certain man in this town, oh, he drank my heart around, yeah. All I've seen, oh, I've got a right to sit and cry down around that old muddy river, soon the deep blue sea. It's gonna be calling me. It must be love, say what you choose. I've got a right to sing the blues. Thank you.
Kerry Smith, Ruby Braff, Bucky Pizzarelli. This next song we're going to play is one that shows a different aspect of the music. In jazz music, we have a lot of humor, a lot of body-type songs, some pristine religious songs. Louis Armstrong is the first jazz musician to start doing songs like "Oh, When the Saints Go Marching In." This next one is in the category of the body song, and it's entitled "It's Tight Like This." So as soon as my music comes, we'll be able to start playing it. Thank you very much. Thank you very, very much, ladies and gentlemen. In closing this first half, we'd like to perform two songs that Louis Armstrong played all the time on the road, even to the end of his career. And it's called The New Orleans Function. The first song is done in the style of a funeral dirge. And that song is entitled Flee as the Bird to the Mountain. And the second song is the happy up-tempo song that we play after we put the body in the ground to signify rebirth. And that tune is entitled Oh Didn't He Ramble.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen. The original Liberty Jazz Band. And of course, the two numbers they just played, Flee as a Bird to the Mountain and Didn't He Ramble. And now, ladies and gentlemen, there will be a brief intermission.
Back to 1923, when Louis recorded this as a member of King Oliver's Creole Jazz Band, one of the greatest jazz bands in history. It is entitled The Dippermouth Blues. And again, this is probably named after somebody back in New Orleans. Of course, they say it was Louis, but you know. Here we go with The Dippermouth Blues. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much, ladies and gentlemen. That was Dipper Mouth Blues, and right now we're going to feature the reigning king of New Orleans trumpet, Mr. Teddy Riley. And he's going to play a tune made famous by the late, great Louis Armstrong once again. It's a tune entitled Mahogany Hall Stomp. Teddy Riley on the trumpet. Thank you. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. This next tune is a song that Louis Armstrong popularized in the 1920s with a recording, on a recording with the great Earl Father Hines. And it's a song entitled Weatherbird Rag. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you very, very much. Right now we have a very, very special guest that we're going to bring up to the stage. This man is one of the greatest musicians of all times, and he's tied in with one of the greatest groups of all times, John Coltrane Quartet. And this reminds me of a story that McCoy Tyner told me one time. He said that they were playing a gig in Chicago with Train's band, and somebody said, Louis Armstrong is in the audience. And McCoy said that he and Elvin ran over to Pops and started talking to him, and McCoy said, man, they had that man all wrong. Standing next to him was like standing near royalty or something. So this man, there's not enough I really can say about him. His presence speaks for itself, really. And he proves that there are really no time divisions in our music. There's no difference between the New Orleans music or bebop or modern or progressive, whatever all the terminology is that's used. Through our music runs a type of joy and swing and humility and nobility that's best exemplified by this very great man. And on this stage, we have a man like Danny Barker. We have youngsters up here like Eric Reed on the piano. He's 20 years old. So we You know, we view our music like a family. You know, you can be 90 years old and you might have a grandchild or a great-grandchild, 5 or 6, and you have the same type of aspirations and feelings for them that your grandparents had for you. So when we look at all of these noble men, I can remember Mr. Danny Barker having us marching around in the hot sun in New Orleans playing Over in That Glory Land when I was 8 years old. And you know, I mean, you know, we didn't feel like doing that. And we'd be saying, man, why are we standing out in this hot sun playing some Over in the Glory Land in this heat? He said it was to professionalize us. He didn't want no amateurs in New Orleans. But anyway, we're going to welcome back Miss Carrie Smith to sing Back of Town Blues and bring on the great Mr. Elvin Jones on the drums. I'm gonna introduce, you got me, Rob? Okay. I'm gonna introduce her one more time because she looks so lovely in that gown. Miss Carrie Smith, Back of Town Blues.
Thank you, Wynton. Thank God for you, baby. You're keeping it alive, honey. Yes, how about that? Back of town. He treated me right, and he never let me down. But I wasn't satisfied. I had to run around. Thank you.
let me down.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Right now, we'd like to bring out one of the great trumpet players of our time. He's a man who I've been knowing for about 10 or 11 years, and he always looked out for me when I first came to New York. And I can remember going on sessions with him where we would play for 3 or 4 hours, and I would get tired playing a part that was 2 octaves below his. And he's a great lover of Louis Armstrong's music. I know I could always go to his apartment and get some new Louis Armstrong records, because he has a library of about 10,000 albums. It's with great pleasure I bring out performing Strutting with Some Barbecue in Hand, Mr. John Faddis on the trumpet. And Doc Cheatham.
Thank you.
Doc Cheatham, John Faddis on trumpets, George Ween on the piano. Go ahead and swing, George. Right now, we're going to bring the chairman of the board of New Orleans Music up to do whatever he wants to do. And he's responsible for so many of the younger musicians in New Orleans, Louisiana, learning how to play the traditional music. He always gives us the good advice, tells us about shining our shoes properly, proper deportment on the bandstand. And there are other musicians like him in other cities. Marcus Belgrave in Detroit. I can't remember all of them, but these musicians, they're not really heralded. They don't get their names in the paper every day, but they contribute so much to the community. And they really are truly unsung heroes because they enable the younger musicians and the younger people to know what is required for development. And I know personally, I only played in the man's band for like 2 months because I didn't feel like carrying my trumpet through those long, hot parades. But it left an indelible impression upon me. And it gives me great honor and pride to be able to be on the same bandstand with this great man. And he's funny, too, as you're about to find out. Mr. Danny Barker on the banjo.
I really don't deserve them. I just like to help youngsters get a start. When you play music, you're not apt to get in trouble real quick because you become celebrated in the neighborhood. So that's what I try to do. I'm from the city of New Orleans, which is 24-hour day town. They don't have curfews there. And I made it with a 100-year-old banjo on my own. And I could always make a buck by going in these joints, dives, after-hour spots, a lot of do-wrong joints, all kind of strange things happening. And I was known as the Peeping Tom because I used to peep through the swinging doors. I could tell you many fascinating stories, but I'm going to stop and give you a song that I heard an old man sing in 1923. He called it the Gambler's Blues, but it's originally named St. James Infirmary, my version. It was down in old Joe's barroom. Corner by the square, the drinks went around as usual, 'cause a goodly crowd was standing there, off in a quiet dark corner, with his eyes bloodshot and red just like mine, sat this wise and slick old-time ancient gambler, Bill Moynihan. And these are the words that the old man said. He said, "I just come from up at the St. James Infirmary, saw my poor baby laying there." He said, "Them slick doctors and them jello-breasted nurses had her stretched out on a long white table. She was so cold, she was so pale, she was so fair laying there. Let her go, God bless her. Wherever she may be, up there or down below with the devil, she can look this cruel, cold, wide, wide, wide world over. But she'll never find another good for fighting sort of type of man like me again. When I die, I want you to dress me in straight lace shoes, put my shoes on because I may have to run from the devil. I want a box back coat and a Stetson hat, put my hat on because the cinders in the fire might be falling. Put a $20 gold piece on my watch chain to blow the Memphis blues as they slowly stroll along. Went down to the St. James Infirmary the second time because I didn't believe what I saw the first time. And sure enough, my poor dead baby was laying there with a sheet overhead. She looked like a gown man. I raised up the sheet and I said, darling, won't you say some nice words of consolation to me? She opened up her eye and said, get the hell away from you. Can't you see I'm trying to pass away? Now that you have heard my story, Mr. Bartender, will you kindly pass me that bottle of Wild Turkey whiskey, because I'm a chronic alcoholic. And if anyone should ask you what's my problem, you just tell them I've got no St. James and farm a
Danny Barker. There he is. We'd like to once again bring Miss Carrie Smith on to do a tune that goes with this last one. It's entitled, I'll Be Glad When You're Dead, You Rascal You.
I'm gonna hang you to a
Rascal Ewing. Now we're going to bring up once again Mr. John Faddis, and he's going to do the king of all trumpet cadenzas and solos, Louis Armstrong's 1927 recording of West End Blues. It uses all 12 notes in the chromatic scale, and it goes into all kind of different times. 1928, I'm sorry. Thank you. 1928 was a few years. So this is something that is as modern as 10 years from now, and it's entitled West End Blues, Mr. John Faddis. John Faddis. Have mercy. This next tune is a song that Louis Armstrong recorded two times, actually, with the great Sidney Bechet. And it's been the hotly debated question as to who cut whose head. And this song is entitled Cake Walking Babies from Home. Right now we're gonna bring out Mr. Faddis and Mr. Cheatham. And they're gonna do, for our next to last song, something that could be called Louis Armstrong's anthem, When You're Smiling. John Faddis, Doc Cheatham. Thank you.
smiling, when you're smiling, whole world smiles with you. And when you're laughing, or laughing, when you're laughing, the sunshine will come through. But if you're crying, it will bring all the rain. So stop complaining and be happy again. When you're smiling, when you're smiling, and the whole world smiles with you.
Ladies and gentlemen, before I introduce the last number, one point of personal privilege. I certainly hope that you have enjoyed this evening as much as I have. One wish that the name of Louis Armstrong live forever. And with the kind of music you've heard tonight, that's more of a certitude than a wish. And now, to bring all of the musicians back onto the stage to give you the final selection of the evening, and that is Second Line.
Thank you. Wynton Marsalis, ladies and gentlemen. John Faddis. Ruby Braff. Doc Cheatham. Bucky Pizzarelli. Gordon Wycliffe and the New Liberty Jazz Band. Elvin Jones. Don't forget Elvin Jones, ladies and gentlemen.